So, to remind people, my paper was the one that had three case studies, you know, critical arts ensemble, and finishing school in America, and Thomas Breslin, an artist that I've worked with in London. And I've discerned maybe four aims of the paper, which are, in order, number one, to propose three examples of contemporary art as candidates for interpretation or understanding of political violence. Two, to consider the possible application of Nato Thompson's definition of socially engaged art, which he lays out in the book Living as Form, and to apply that to art activism. And this assumes, I think, art activism to be a subset or a kind of socially engaged art, which you may want to disagree with. My third aim is to propose that art can rob states or other kinds of power elites of their legitimacy or power simply by exposing political violence or state violence. I thought of a couple of examples not in my paper, two of which are from Boris Groys's book Art Power, which is the idea of after the French Revolution, rather than kind of burning the royal family's art collection, just opening it up in the Louvre as a museum, because when you make it into a museum, you kind of rob it of its legitimacy or power. And his other example is Lenin's tomb, the idea that, you know, it looks like a, you know, great mausoleum, but really it serves to say he's dead, look, he's impotent now, not so scary. And then I thought of my own example, which is The Wizard of Oz, obviously the kind of unveiling of the wizards, the harmless little old man hiding behind a big megaphone and a curtain. And the fourth and final aim is to consider such acts, these acts that I've been describing, exposing state violence, as counter-systemic violence. I've kind of borrowed that from the Zizek term of systemic violence, so I'm looking at counter-systemic violence, which is very undeveloped in the paper, but quite like the way it sounds now, so maybe that could be developed into something good. And I think that segues with Amy's section on in her paper, which she calls making the deniable undeniable. And there are some kind of other examples in Jill's presentation. She mentioned the yes men, and they have this term identity correction, which is naming and shaming corporations for, usually corporations, for unethical practices. And there's an Argentine collective called Grupo Etc. that done some work on, who, together with other kinds of collectives in Argentina, have developed something called escraches, which is simply naming and shaming of politicians who are responsible for genocides or the disappeared during the military dictatorship. So literally there might be a road sign that says mass murderer and lives 200 yards on the right, or something like that. And those are the four ends of my paper, that's what I've got to say. I'll be sure.
Okay, so just to remind you, I'm Vlad, this is Jaco, and we've written a paper on Sigma. Just to give you a bit of context how we arrived at this point, I've done a PhD, which is roughly about intellectual history, a possible intellectual history of institutional critique, and Jaco is he's in the last stages of his PhD. He's writing about Guattari and the concept of production of subjectivity and the new aesthetic paradigm. And we used an opportunity to get some HRC money, and we went to Glasgow. We spent some time in the RD archive there. And is it okay? And of course, RD Lang is very much, very much involved in well, very much more or less involved in Project Sigma.
Yeah. I'm not confusing it.
That has to be on you.
Yeah, so we will talk about this Project Sigma.
Yeah, so
this is from the 60s.
So I'm going to say a couple of words about what Sigma is, and then we're just going to try to quickly answer Luke's questions, the core questions. Basically, Sigma was a network of practitioners. Of course, the main figure behind it was Alex Trocki, who's a writer, quite famous writer. Back in the 60s, but in this network, Artie Lang was involved as well, William Burroughs was involved, and a host of other people. And Sigma, the idea of Sigma, Sigma is actually a letter, we write this in the text, a letter taken from the Greek alphabet. It expresses summation. It also expresses standard deviation, which is a bit more complicated, but the idea behind it is how people are connected how entities are connected to each other in a group. And it was really interesting because we think that they exhibit a very interesting case study of activism, maybe avant la lettre. I don't think they were talking about activism at the time.
No.
They were actively doing stuff, so they were actually publishing, like this is what were mostly they were active in, like publishing and distributing texts and trying to intervene in mass media.
This is the most important one. This is the moving times was something that they wanted to distribute in the subway.
Yes.
So in a way, kind of the moving times is something is an alternative type the times.
Yes, exactly. So this is the poster. It's a huge A0 poster that you can find in the British Library. As you can see, it has texts from written by several authors. William Burroughs is there as well. There's a bit of his part here is the conclusion of Sigma, a tactical blueprint.
Yeah, mostly it's fiction, actually.
Yes, yes.
So it's fiction like writing, and it's kind of very weird kind of document. And they and in here we can see that they said that they want to that the London Transport refused to accept it on grounds too ambiguous for description here. It is our feeling, it was their feeling, the article was just a wee bit too far out, as they say. So, but like at the same time, they're very sure that that everyone will want to have this kind of, you know, this moving times will go to all the, you know, subways of the world.
Yeah, and this is what actually surprises us. There's this sort of sheer optimism that they will finally make it, they will be out there, they will distribute their stuff, and they will be able to create a sort of a massive change, which is kind of like we were talking this morning, is quite the opposite of Alex Trocki's writing style, which is quite depressive.
Yeah, very nihilistic and kind of, negative in a way.
Yeah. But anyway, let's proceed to the question.
Yeah.
So Jaco is going to respond to the first question, I'm going to respond to the second one, and then again Jaco will be there.
So in a way, in this Sigma's context, the art activism, how is it defined or described? So what they kind of thought that they will do, that what they wanted to do is that they want to seize the grids of expression. And that actually means those of art and literature. And through the spontaneous university. So they want to create a kind of an alternative public sphere with a specific focus on publishing. And in a way, they kind of make, you can see in this this one, it's an early case of kind of this kind of counter advertisement tactics. So in a way, the seizing the grids of expression within this kind of spontaneous university requires this kind of total transformation of the art context. That all of the Sigma's activity, the writing, publishing, and distributing of the Sigma portfolio was seen as art or a part of an artistic process. So in a way, for them, every act, if an act is a political act, it must contain a creative comportment. That's what they say. So they have a new concept of art, which is living art as opposed to dead art. This is very kind of, they have a very close connection to the situationists also. So the dead art is things kind of museums and their collection policies, but in general the institutional establishment. And they are the opposition within the opposition. They don't have a political position. They say that we don't subscribe to any politics. But this precisely is a kind of activist position for them, and this kind of from this kind of existentialist thought that they come from.
This is our interpretation.
Yeah. No, but So they want, they like, what they kind of say is that like they can't like react with force towards the like the force of the state. So they don't want a political revolt, but it's a kind of a psychic revolt, an insurrection of million minds. That's what they say.
Yeah, and in the text we wrote about this image of the mental jujitsu. This is very important. So for them, like violence, at least in our interpretation, violence, it's already like whatever is vertical, hierarchical, whatever is state institution, traditional party politics, and so on, this is violence. It's violence, and this is why they propose this other model, which is the spontaneous university. And it's violence because structures will stifle creativity. So they say that you can't be creative. So this is why we need another form of education. We need this kind of spontaneous university. There is a model there, just like Oxford broke away from the Sorbonne and Cambridge broke away from Oxford. We need to break away from the current educational system which stifles creativity. We need to create a new university. It has to be on the bank of a river, they say, not very far away from London, because we need to go back to these urban centers and kind of do our stuff there. But there, in the spontaneous university, we have together scientists, artists, psychiatrists, and so on and so forth, and just allow creativity to run free. So this is one response to violence, hierarchical violence, vertical violence, and the other one, of course, and I we think that this is Lang's influence quite a lot here. Lang was a reader of Sartre, and the concept of experience is very important there, and of course, like there are texts written by Trotsky with reference to drugs. The concept of experience and the violence of, against experiencing certain things is another important component. With Lang, it gets more specific because Lang has this concept that actually the psychotic or psychosis and schizophrenia is a sort of a natural recovery mechanism against alienation. So psychosis is a sort of a recovery mechanism of the body and mind. So what happens in the psychiatric institution is violence, because you know you are not allowed to live through the psychotic episode up to the end. And this is kind of taken back into talking about experience with drugs, with certain drugs, which kind of allow one to experience different sort of reality.
Yeah, so there's the world. So there is two kinds of violence. There is the violence of the state that is kind of like overwhelming, and then there is a violence towards an experience of an individual that can be emancipatory in a way.
Right.
That's like kind of our argument. And like for this schema to work in a way, like for Sigma, the public in a way is already there. Like the public that they are kind of addressing, they are addressing it to the million minds, the creative men usually. Like and the kind there is this kind of male. Point there that like they think that they kind of are there already, the creative guys that are kind of that have already gone this underground, this like mental jujitsu kind of thing, that they have become aware of their own conditions of existence.
So there's a critical mass of people.
Yeah, but they don't really know that they are already part of the movement. So Sigma just has to like, kind of communicate to them that okay, now you are actually there is this is an actual movement.
Yeah, so that's the idea of the publics.
Yeah, and so
that's the last question.
Yeah, I can say that also. Like, so how are art interventions designed to shift, challenge, or respond? So in a way, they are kind of they kind of want to like create this kind of parallel structure. I was kind of interested about this when Erdogan was talking about the parallel structure that it's there. So they want to kind of create this kind of parallel structure, but it's a cultural organization. It's what they call, it's a super categorical cultural organization. So in a way, they kind of think that there is that it's all kind of spiritual. The enemy is spiritual. It's kind of, it's about the consciousness of the people. They kind of think that all of us in a way, the mass of men, they are kind of like indoctrinated by the state in a way that they're like we are among the news apparatus or whatever, these kind of things. And it's just that, that we, through these million men, we can kind of take that kind of illusion away.
There is an interesting thing. So I think that he would say there is no public perception of violence because most of the people are kind of being trapped, and this is a situation study, of course, they're being trapped in the spectacle. So we don't perceive violence. However, this enlightened few, this million minds, they are able to see it, and it's from them that like the insurrection starts.
Thanks a lot. So my paper is on the prophetic medical activism. I'm interested in the type of art activism which could promote political tolerance, specifically in my country, Ethiopia. So, Ethiopia is a federal state. This is the political map of Ethiopia. This is the flag. And the country is characterized by a very polarized political culture. And we have many different groups, religion, basically, more than 85 ethnic groups speaking 85 languages and different religion. So the society is so divided in terms of these elements. And there are feelings of historical injustice, deprivation, all these things. And we don't have a very critical media in society as well. People take everything as granted, you know, as they just had. So this is the political landscape of Ethiopia. And I am thinking, what type of, especially the musical activism, could work better for political promotion in the country? There are types of art activism. One, the pragmatic art activism that describes the existing scenario in society. For example, if there is a polarized politics, musicians or songwriters will align themselves with either of the political groups in the country. So if there is a good political situation in the country, they will also follow that trend normally. So I believe that the type of this pragmatic type of music function in countries like Ethiopia will sharpen or create more cleavage among the society. It widens the gap. It does look for the linking elements among these different groups of members of the society. The second one, this prophetic activist role of music, just described by Thomas Brook, an American artist and author, it looks for the linking elements within a society, within a divided society, and just work to create harmony among these groups. And he called it prophetic, if they work this way. So I'm just thinking that if this could be the best in our situation. In our constitution, it says we need to go for unity in diversity. We need to create a society that embraces multiculturalism, but at the same time to live in one country, because there is this fear of disintegration. All the time, political competitors come to the stage. They talk about this disintegration. Some of them would like to secede from the country, and some of them push for a strong united country. And some of the artists, especially many of the ethnic-based songwriters, tend to support the secessionist groups. And as a unity lover, I would like to see them advocating love, tolerance, and go for unity. And I propose that this prophetic approach of musical activism would be a good one. That's my point. I hope I may say.
Yes,
thank
you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so I focused on the question about how political violence can be sort of interpreted through arts activism. And this isn't really my field of expertise, so I kind of avoided theory as much as possible and just focused on a couple of more practical aspects. And like I said in my introduction, when we were introducing ourselves earlier, I work in, I'm based in a research group which looks at state criminality and then what civil society can do to label that as such and to try and resist and constrain it. And I'm focusing on border controls within that. So really I just looked at two main aspects, the first of which being trying to cut through the tactics that states use to try and deny or hide or justify the actions, their actions. So about delegitimizing state behavior. And just a couple of thoughts about that, just trying to put the state's actions to the fore in work, because, I mean, I'm thinking about it more in terms of migration, but sometimes situations are presented as these tragedies and the structural, the structures that have gone on behind the scenes to make those tragedies occur aren't necessarily focused upon. And then other things being, so I'm looking at public interventions and therefore accessibility and being able to understand work is obviously important, because a lot of the audience potentially going to be people who are just passing who aren't particularly interested. So very intelligent, complex work presented in galleries on the street maybe doesn't translate well. And then another thing potentially to be being aware of is timing, not just in terms of reacting to state action, but being aware of other civil society organising and going on around the same issues, so that you're together, not necessarily working with, say, social movements or organisations, but timing it so that the censure is increased, so criticism is increased. And then I just moved on to talk about other ways of potentially countering tactics such as dehumanisation of those who experience this type of violence. So that would be sort of, yeah, rehumanising those who've been on the receiving end, so that potentially a general understanding of the facts of the situation can be translated into a sort of a deeper understanding of what those realities really are. One way people might go about doing that is to try and pick out personal stories within this sort of, for example, yeah, so a mass of sort of faceless refugees, picking out one individual story to try and encourage some kind of connection. But then I talked really briefly about the difficulties there, potentially between empathy and pity, and not presenting perhaps these two-dimensional figures to be pitied. Another way, and again I talked about this really briefly, talking about trying to encourage your participants, your audience, to somehow embody those experiences or directly witness those experiences. And again, I just mentioned one potential problem with that would be it might be counterproductive in terms of if people are left feeling very guilty or powerless, their own personal walls of denial may go up, and it might not lead to further action on the part of those who experience the work. So that was it, really, just trying to create work that helps those viewing it to understand the situation, but the state's behaviour, the state's actions within that, and then to develop some sort of deeper understanding above and beyond just the facts of the matter, so that potentially that might spur on future action.
So, yeah. So I'm talking to you most of it. So my paper is kind of about a project that I run called Cobra Base, and it responds to the National Emergency Committee Cobra, which is Cabinet Office Briefing Room A. I've run this project for about 2 years, well, sort of 3 years, but the last year we haven't really been able to respond to, and I'll come to that at the end. But what I wanted to do quickly was, well, one point I wanted to make as well is in terms of Ongreve, in fact, the Cobra Committee kind of was formed because of that, or at least this kind of idea of a domestic war cabinet. There's people say that it was formed in kind of 1974, others say 1984. But the kind of basic principle is that it's an executive committee that meets under moments of emergency, that they define themselves. These are the meetings that are out of date, because I haven't updated it. But there are other ones more recently, but it goes back to kind of, I sort of started in 2007, I started kind of following this a little bit. So you can see the sort of general events that it meets over. The famous ones are kind of foot and mouth outbreak, the summer riots in London, the London Olympics, when the committee decided to put anti-aircraft guns on domestic rooftops. So they're a kind of mixture of things, but predominantly they're kind of becoming more and more violent based with the rise of ISIS and sort of so-called Islamic terrorism sort of taking greater form and effect in Europe. Again, I'm going to throw some of these very fast, but just the idea is that Cobra is a very performative thing, so we look at it, that's what Stephen was talking about earlier, it's a very performative name, and it suggests lots of things. So if you think about the snake, the actual Cobra snake, it's a snake that doesn't strike immediately. It raises up, it expands its hood, and it kind of does a dance, and it may spit at you as a spitting cobra, or you also have the sovereign cobra, which is another name. Whereas a black mamba will bite you almost immediately without thought. So the idea is, how does the state perform its response to violence? So that's kind of why I set up this project, to kind of look at that and to analyse this moment. This is the only official image of the Cobra Committee room, which has sort of looked like it's been taken on a dodgy old Nokia. But then there's an artist in, I can't remember his name, David Moore. We photographed the inside of it, so it's a very kind of slick corporate space. It's basically a kind of situation room, as you have in America. And I love that they have this kind of video link or some kind of CCTV camera on top. And then the very sort of corporate looking, I mean secure looking corporate office. And then Cobra Res. So Cobra Res set up 2013. And our first one was to respond to the hostages held at a gas plant in Algeria. And we've gone through, we've done maybe a few more than that now. But this is generally what we've responded to. So you have the main flooding in Britain, which is a DVD and a book of art films people submitted. And then we did, which one was this? Oh yeah, Cobra 1.4, 1.5, 1.6 is a book in response to three events that happened. The Malaysia Airlines flight MH17 and shutdown of Ukraine, and the outbreak of Ebola in West Africa, and the rise of ISIS. And so we created Black Box, Top Trumps, Pandemic Snap, and NATO Happy Families. Because we saw the kind of the narrative around these things becoming like a game, really. Someone mentioned it earlier. This sort of the way that the state produces narratives and the images that they use. So we try and counter that. I don't know how successful we are, but we have fun trying. I'm going to zoom through these very quickly. Well, you should check these out. These are Daily Mail. Look at that. I love these. I collect these images. And we have exhibitions of work. And these are sort of some of the things we invite people along. So it's all pretty much in an art context. This was the beheading of Lee Rigby in Woolwich, who produced a book. If I go down, had a walking tour beforehand, which is some of the work committed. So it's very fast. I'm trying to just get through some very fast. So the idea, really, I'm just going to leave it on that. The idea, really, and the reason I think this is an interesting workshop for me personally is that, and for the project, is the project ran for 2 years, and we did these events, and we published books, and we had this kind of art-based events. And then we did one in response to the COBRA meeting over the refugee crisis in Calais. And we produced a book, a flash fiction, and it was all kind of, it was all fun, and it was great, and it worked, and we raised a bit of money, and we donated that to Calais. But it sort of wondered, what were we doing, really? What was our agency, and why were we just making kind of sort of a book in response to an event that was ongoing? Whereas most of our responses before, events that have happened, and then they dissipate, and we kind of, everything moves on. So the idea now is to maybe change the project and try and put it back into the street, and make a kind of citizens' response committee, possibly, using maybe minor architecture and new technology, and try and engage with these events as they're happening, but less art, more kind of politics. But maybe it exists, not necessarily just within the art world, but it exists more in the political world as well, in public. So that's the kind of general questions that I have, that I'm hoping to not necessarily get solved here, but that I'm thinking around, I guess, how to make it more, how to engage with these events long term, I guess, is the idea, really. There you go.
Thank you.
So I've brought these things, if you want to have a look at them, I'll go over there.
So just a couple of images to show. So just wanted to today refer to, I think, the second question on the list of four, about how we can look at violence through our activism, or how that kind of maybe subverts what we consider to be violence. And I want to just talk specifically about this one artwork by Sun Yuan and Peng Yu that was in 2009. In this artwork, the artist gave 100 migrant domestic workers in Hong Kong a toy plastic grenade and asked them to photograph it in the home of their employers. You can see it's not immediately obvious to me, but it's just on the table. And they exhibited this in a gallery where they had all the different photographs, about 100, I think. And what I was interested in this project was, first of all, interpreting it with relation to Hannah Arendt's writings on violence and power, and her writings on what she calls the space of appearance. And, well, first of all, I wanted to think about how it opens up a space of appearance. So for Hannah Arendt, the space is like a contemporary polis, but she is quite critical of the idea of the polis. So she sort of unmoors it from the traditional meaning, Greek meaning of the city-state. And she's looking at it as a kind of informal space that emerges when people come together for open discussion and to talk and discuss and debate particular issues in an open way. And there's a number of ways in which she defines the space of appearance. So that's the first one, that's informality. So it's not something that is instigated by the state, something that comes about in kind of unpredictable ways. And this space is when people appear together to create a kind of relationality and an accountability to the other. And so because of this, it's precarious. It can disappear very quickly. As soon as that openness and that deliberation ends, the space of appearance is over. And so to be in the space kind of involves a kind of suspension of what somebody is, and Hannah Arendt distinguishes between what we are and who we are. So what we are being the things that distinguish us publicly, and who we are being the person we are in the moment, how we relate to that other person. And she says, when you're in the space of appearance, you let go of what you are, and you are just who you are in that relational bond. And as you can see with this piece, it was actually a huge risk for the migrant domestic workers in the piece, because
they were risking their jobs and their income and their ability to stay in Hong Kong. So just a bit of context actually around working conditions for migrant workers in Hong Kong. I lived there for a couple of years as an English teacher, quite a long time ago now, when this exhibition was on. And I was a migrant worker, but of a very, very different sort to how domestic workers are conceived as migrant workers. Now, if you're a domestic worker and you lose your job, you have 2 weeks in which to find another job, otherwise you are obliged to leave Hong Kong. And they have very few rights. The laws around the living conditions for domestic workers are very vague, and it's really common to find that maids sleep in cupboards in the kitchen, and that they are under 24-hour surveillance, and there's a lot of abuse that has gone on over the years. And so there's a couple of charities in Hong Kong that offer respite and help people who are dealing with those immediate situations of violence. And this exhibition actually, as it unfolded over time, first of all it became very much about how audiences felt about the content, about how that a person who maybe has an aide or knows an aide would understand that experience of being a migrant worker in those conditions. And then it kind of expanded and it moved to Singapore and it became involved in art there, and the kind of context of the exhibition really opened up. And what I found quite interesting was that as it kind of got absorbed into the art world, some of the kind of initial characteristics which made it a space of appearance seemed to sort of fade away, and it gradually sort of, the artists, without intending to, sort of recreated some of the conditions that they were fighting against in the first place. For example, they became famous because 100 migrant domestic workers had worked for free and done maybe photographs, and these two people were becoming known for it. So it kind of strangely ended up sort of having a kind of lifespan almost, this artwork, in terms of its political affect. Now, in terms of power and violence, which is the other thing I wanted to talk about in this, was the sense of power that emerged in this exhibition with the sheer number of people who were involved in it. And Hannah Arendt has this idea that power is something that comes from grassroots collectivity, that it comes from the bottom up, from us collaborating, from acting in concert. On the other hand, she says violence is something that is top down. Usually violence comes into play because there's a particular goal, it's in the name of particular ends. And she says that with power, you can't think what happens when power isn't there. Power is always there, in the same way that you can't say what comes after peace. So it's a kind of something that is emergent, and it's infinite, really, where in comparison with violence, which is very specific and measured, and it's often very measured, all for specific ends. So what I wanted to suggest in my paper was that cultural objects, artworks, performances, art activism can create kind of cracks in social norms, and that they can create these spaces of appearance, these precarious spaces of appearance. And I'm interested in how a space of appearance can open up, like this work did, and how it can gradually crystallize, but how we can then open up that space again using more tools of representation. And what I would be interested in discussing more in this workshop is perhaps similar to what you were just saying just now, is that about how you sustain those spaces, how you kind of keep it going. And Arendt speaks about the desert. She says the desert grows because, well, we live in a desert and we have these oases, these kind of cultural oases, but when we go into them, we take the sand of the desert with us and gradually kind of lose them. So I'm interested in how we can kind of keep these oases, these spaces of appearances, flourishing, so that they can continue to generate critical engagement and actually create concrete social changes. Thank you.
This is a short presentation. I just want to show you some examples of art from Ukraine. And I was mostly interested in the question about how art iterations designed to shift, challenge, and respond to public perceptions of political violence. And most of my research are in the spheres of migration studies and urban research. And I did a lot of studies of migrants in Russia, and having the project on asylum seekers from Eastern Ukraine and Russia, I was, so their stories, their biographies, so how they used to live there and what happened, so the armed conflict is still going on, if you know, and the context you can see in my paper. And it's a divided Ukraine, a two self-proclaimed republic recreated. And the information about how people live there is very, very limited because people have very restricted access to internet, and so there are some journalists who work invisibly there and who can provide some information. And then when I started to think more about conflict, I found a lot of insights from artists who used to be there, but who became a refugee as well, to internally displaced or moved to other countries. And the symbolism in the artworks tell a lot about the even Eastern Ukraine and tell a lot about conflict there. Yeah, a big project proposal to art for interviews with artists by Skype or face to face if they come to England. So I will not tell about very much, but just show some examples. So on the first slide, you can see installation which made on a space of a big industrial plant in Donetsk, the capital of now it calls Donetsk People Republic. So the plant lipstick, so it's abandoned plant which became a residency for art group which calls Platform for Cultural Initiative Izolyatsiya, who had to leave Donetsk in 2014 and now based in Kyiv because terrorists attacked the office, occupied all space, and now there is a Ministry of Military Affairs and a prison in the premises, which is also symbolism. And here is some, so, and they still reflect what happened with some exhibitions and installations. Here is the famous art intervention in the Venice Biennale, which were not an official program of Venice Biennale, but they just captured the Russian pavilion in Venice and called it on vacation, because if you know when things happened in Crimea and annexation, so there were a lot of military men in a green, you know, green uniform, but without any signs whom they belong. So, and they say that we are on vacation here, right? So it was very successful art intervention about what happened there. But to tell more about artist Masha Kudakovska, who now lives in Sweden. She originally from Crimea, but she used to work in Donetsk, in Izolyatsiya, and she made lots of statues of her body made from soap, and it was a very traumatic, physically traumatic experience. And when terrorists captured the office, first of all, they shoot the sculptures. And talking to her, still I could feel how emotional it was for her, because she said that she could still feel that physical pain, and that all her sculptures was, you know, destroyed there. And it was also, you know, against feminism and against what she wanted to show, just her body, not probably beautiful, right? But who has a right, you know, to die, who have a right to be old, but by her own, not from somebody else's hands. And then she repeated that sculptures, but in a Saatchi gallery last year, and then she destroyed them by hammer by herself, just to show that only she has a right for, you know, for body. And it was again response and again a communication with the terrorists and what happened. it's here in Asia, action, legal action, 254, it's how in Ukraine named, how to say, named Buddhists, which arrived from Donetsk after war. So, and she was in Hermitage, but like an unofficial guest, and then she lay down on the steps and covered herself by love. And then she was taken by police, but police wasn't able to indict her anything, and then she was free. And there is a famous action of Russian artist now, Pavlensky, and I know that Claudia works on Russian action art. So his intervention to support Ukrainian Euromaidan, and I just think that in his work there are lots of, lots of talk to, again, authoritarianism and totalitarianism, like in the works of Masha Kulikovsky and other artists. Sergei Zakharov, art group Murzilki, who is from Donetsk originally, so he was making such a caricatures of leaders of a terrorist group who became, let's say, president of the self-proclaimed republics and put them in public spaces, and then they were captured and burned and so on, and he spent about 2 months in prison there, and finally was able to escape. And also I think your group used cards as well, and he used cards with the pictures of Putin and the leaders of this proclaimed republic, just to show how it's fragile. Another response to this conflict was of Alektina Hakidze from Kyiv, but who is originally from eastern Ukraine, and her mom is still there where military actions are, and she calls her every day, and she can't see her for 2 years, and in her pictures and in her book which she published, she reflects what's going on. And I want to emphasize on several questions and discussions in the future discussion, which are particularly interesting for me. Mm-hmm. So the question is about how we can research public effect from artistic interventions in very closed and authoritarian states or quasi-states like Eastern Ukraine. So when we don't have access to the territories, and you know, so how we can know that, for example, Sergei Zakharov caricatures made an impact or not, so how to trace it and how to research it. And then I think very interesting about time and space categories. So for example, status of Maria Kulikovska in Donetsk were created before war, but then they found out another sense, another meaning after war started, and it's also very interesting a question to think about. Also, I want to think more about how we can engage with concept of air and atmosphere, because a lot of artist interventions take place in an open air, and they create what geographers say now atmosphere, but still there is no, let's say, many concept of it, and how we can engage with the term of atmosphere and air, talking about political art. And also how art can be a tool against any geopolitical order. And in critical geopolitical theory, there is still no answer about it. So in an engagement with the discourse theory and the other approaches, so can be discussed. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so I'm on the working on this exhibition of refugee voucher, and so the essay which I said along was a draft of the catalog intro. So you might be wondering why it doesn't particularly talk about violence. So I'll sort of tease out a few things here. So G. Voucher is mainly known as being the sort of designer for the anarchist punk band Crass. Have folks come across her work at all, or maybe playing with her? John Savage credited them in the early 80s with basically reviving anarchism in the UK in a more serious manner, which is kind of funny in the sense that they weren't really anarchists. So what I'm interested in their work is, well, a few things. I'll draw a few points. One is I'm interested in the way that she's, with her work with crafts, sort of expanded the spaces in which sort of art was used in a sort of critical dimension. So for instance, not just in sort of, so taking sort of the space of Album Coast very seriously, trying to organize their events in public sort of, in halls and unexpected spaces, trying to expand the circulation of where the work was going. So not getting sucked into the commercial, you know, the commercial world of music or the sort of gallery scene. So sort of the politics of expanding, you might call it the alternative public space, sort of like Sigma, sort of like a few parts that I've mentioned. And that's had interesting sort of afterlives, sort of as Julian was talking about a bit. So in particular thinking about violence, there's a number of ways in which violence appears in G's work. One most obvious one, it would be that when she has her main influences, she talks about being very influenced by the Campaign for Legal Disarmament, which is sort of the anti-nuclear campaign group that started in the late 50s, early 60s, the exact year. And she also talks about a lot about how she was, I put down the wrong date, Epiphany disaster, it happens in September 21st, 1966, which was the collapse of it's when you have the sort of industrial waste from sort of when coal gets mined.
Slightly
collapsed and crushed a school and killed a hundred of students. So you can see through her work, she's looking at questions of violence, both at sort of a, let's say, macro political scale, so violence in terms of war, the violence of the state. And then you might look at, and there's also sort of, you might call it, say, micro-political violence. So violence of sexism, gender roles, interiorized norms of control. So there are these two different sort of scales of sort of violence, large-scale violence and sort of, small, but sort of, let's say, psychological violence. So if you look at the image here on the right, which is from her work project from the mid-70s, the National Anthem, you have a sort of a school scene where you have, I guess, the mother figure who is holding a hammer to a baby's head, which sort of, you might say, mimics the kind of violence which is being portrayed in sort of the regimented environment of the school, which is sort of the idea of being factory or prison. And then next we have, let's say, kind of this kind of absurd form of masculinity that is trying to show how tough he is. So it's this relationship between sort of, outer structural violence and what happens when that's interiorized. Here we have a nice smiley face on a soldier, sort of playing with the same sort of idea of outer violence and inner violence, and how these two different levels come together. One of the things that I found most interesting, in this sense of what I said, is when I talk with G about her work, she constantly talks about how she, all of her ideas come to her through gardening. So she spends all the time in the garden at Dial House. And sort of Dial House is this sort of space, it's an epping about 50 miles east of London, where its function is a kind of, I won't say retreat, but sort of because it's out of the cities, out of London, where it's been this sort of important connection between different kinds of art and counterculture. So the first free festivals, like Windsor and Stonehenge, were planned there in the mid-70s. Crass comes out of there. You could look at all these different sort of projects that flow through that kind of space. Maybe similar to the way certain projects emerged out of the London Free University or the United University in the 60s. So you mentioned how you have these spaces which are out, sort of seeming to be outside of everyday life, which then sort of projects emerge out of. Just two more things. This wonderful project that she did in the mid-90s is really showing how sort of, one thing you're constantly seeing in a lot of work is this sort of ripping or cutting of the face, and she uses, in this particular project, she's using sort of images of animal-human relationships to explore sort of the psychological dynamics of relationships, usually how they're quite either malformed or go a bit strange. And last thing I'll bring, just mention a quick project, is this is a project she's working on since 2012 called Knots, and it starts with two things. One is Max Ernst put this collage novel called Week of Kindness in the mid-30s, which he sort of tore apart Victorian pulp novels. And then R.D.U. Lang, in the mid-60s, had a book called Knots, which is about sort of the time bitter complications of human relationships. So the point where people get stuck in a kind of oppressive knot with each other, and how these, you know. And so what she tried to do is she took Ernst's original collages, this is actually kind of crazy, removed all the figures by sort of erasing them, and then sort of decided to redo them, draw them on R.E. Lang's insights. And in a way, it's sort of actually, it's almost a perfect summary of I think what her project is, which is kind of a surrealism meets a kind of sort of radical psychoanalysis, exploring this relationship between inner and outer violence. And I think that's an interesting way to think about her work. And I think, so I guess is how to cross those different kinds of, let's say, micro-political and structural forms of violence in representation and in our strategic practice.
So the main goal of my paper is to show the evolution of Russian activists who, from the resistance commentators of political phenomena, became art activists, and they became very involved in their political life through their art. And I also showed very sketchy three of the most important case studies of contemporary artists, which would be Pussy Riot, Grupa Wojna, and Kertanowski. So on this slide, you can see actually the first wave artists, and they're the most famous performance done by Oleg Kulik and Alexander Brenner. And this first wave, in my essay, is called Consensus because of their distance from the current life and societal feedback that they gave, that they obtained. And the main clue of them is that they responded to the chaos and instability of 1990s by placing themselves in the position of external spectators and commentators, but they were never involved in the current politics, so they never participated. And the period of the second wave of artistic activity of Actionists reached its peak in the years of Dmitry Medvedev's presidency, so around 2010, and overlapped with the last protest movement, which happened in 2011. So although drawing the clear line between protest and artistic activity is actually not possible, I would like to say that the new wave of Actionists became an exemplification of Jacques Rancière's theory of inseparable connection between aesthetics and politics. So, contrary to artists of 1990s, the new Actionists started acting in the public sphere during the highly politicized time and demonstrated dissensus against current politics. And together with the change in the character of their activity, the public discourse about them also changed. And from insanes, like in here, they became hooligans, maids of Satan, and contemporary Hollywoods, and even sometimes terrorists. I will show you also now the three case studies. So this first one that you can see here is Grupa Wojna, and they were called by Alec Epstein the first successful art activist project in Russia. And they were the most active in the early 2000s, so actually before the protest started. Their program has only two main aims, and it's about demonstrating disagreement with current politics and to show to society the culture of rebellion. And on the slide you can see their performance from 2007. And at this performance they were having public sex in the Museum of Biology. And the main goal was to protest the beard policy of Dmitry Medvedev. This one is probably the most well-known case. This is Pussy Riot. And they became well-known after the performance, which is depicted here, and Mother of God, Guy Putin Away. In fact, it wasn't their first performance, it was their sixth performance, so they weren't new to the art scene. And this performance actually became a culmination of protest, the symbol of the protest, but also the excuse for brutal pacification of the protest, detaining the leaders and also sending the girls for 2 years in prison camps. They actually, thanks to this performance, managed to protest against union of the state and the Orthodox Church. And here we have the last one, Piotr Pawlewski, who was already mentioned today. He became famous in 2013 at the very end of protest after his performance Fixation, which you can see here. He nailed his scrotum to Red Square in the protest against stagnation in the Russian society. And his performances in my film are always about his body, which he uses as a metaphor of the society, and shocking gestures against this body, through which he challenges norms and processes within society. And this kind of activity turns him into a contemporary version of Holy Food for Christ, which is in Russian called Eurovision. And so what I'm trying to say here is that, in my opinion, around 2010, politics and aesthetics in Russia actually merged. And what is the most interesting for me from these cases is to go very deep and to see all the mechanisms that are protested and that are shown in those case studies.
Well, I'm just going to show you 2 minutes from this film that I've made called How They Hate Us. I've kind of had a lot of difficulty distilling my thoughts around art and violence in particular, how the two go together, and as you will note from the notes that I submitted in lieu of a kind of more refined written essay, my ideas around violence kind of emerged from, I suppose, from Marxism and the idea in Marxism that violence begins in work, basically, and alienated labour is the kind of the violence that capitalism and the capitalist system ensures that everyone suffers on a day-to-day basis. I suppose the opposite to that is non-alienated labour, or artistic form, or the artist exists in a world of, in theory, in old Marxist terms anyway, in a world of non-alienated labour. So there's always been this contrast between alienated labour and non-alienated labour. So there must be some kind of norm, if you like, which is a starting point for a non-violent position. Position of non-violence, and I suppose the Hannah Arendt definition of collectivity is probably as good a place to start, really. I do have some thoughts about violence, but they're not very incisive, really. I mean, I just kind of like violence disrupts narrative and norms, really. But I do think there is a notion of, I mean, one of the reasons why this notion of violence interests me is because in countering the violence of the state, there is a sense in which you can either react in a violent way or you can react in a peaceful way. And all the projects that have been outlined today have been obviously been peaceful responses. Is there a sense in which art activism can be violent? I mean, that is kind of one of the questions that one should perhaps ask. Or is art activism always does it always take a non-violent form? And this particular clip, I mean, this film, I don't know if you remember what I wrote, but in How They Hate Us, I set out to explore how Franz Kafka has been appropriated by Israel, and that's kind of expression of Israelis, the Israeli violence, the state violence towards the Palestinians, and the way it kind of buttresses and supports its own kind of top-down violence, if you like. So the film specifically was made in response to the decision by the Israeli courts that Franz Kafka's manuscripts, originally brought to the Palestine stroke Israel by Max Brod, rightfully belonged to the Israeli National Library. And the decision was that, yes, partly because Franz Kafka was Jewish, the Israeli state enabled, the judiciary in Israel enabled this transfer of these manuscripts, which included the trial and America, amongst a lot of correspondences and letters that Kafka wrote. They enabled that transfer to happen from the two women that inherited the manuscripts to the Israeli Library, to the National Library, where they now belong. And one of the reasons the judge gave that allowed this to happen was because Kafka was Jewish, therefore, you know, because Kafka was Jewish, these things naturally belong to the State of Israel. In the film, Mohammed Bakri is seen reading Jackals and Arabs to camera. The story itself relates an encounter between a group of jackals and a visitor from the north. Claiming the visitor as their savior, they speak of their hatred for the Arabs and try to persuade him to the sleeping Arabs with a rusty pair of scissors. Just try to persuade him to kill the sleeping Arabs with a rusty pair of scissors. The visitor refuses, and soon the Arabs have woken up and placated the jackals by throwing them on the carcass of a dead camel. The final line in the story is quite crucial, and it has the Arab leader saying to the jackals, "Marvelous creatures, aren't they? And how they hate us." Now, the Arabs are obviously representatives of the kind of natives, if you like, of Palestine, and the jackals can be seen, and perhaps should be seen, as representation of the colonizing Jews in Israel, or Palestine as it was then. So he says, "Marvelous creatures, aren't they? And how they hate us." And at this point in the film, Bakri's eyes look into the distance and he hesitates slightly. Now, whilst editing the film, I saw this moment as significant for someone like Bakri to negotiate. Being a well-known Palestinian Israeli actor, he is a long-suffering subject of oppression. So he's kind of, it's this kind of gestural moment, he's kind of stepping out of the story to contemplate the ramifications of what he is reading. It's a moment that both undoes and heightens narrative performativity, and made me think about this notion. It's kind of from meeting Bakri and from talking to him and from his performance, I got this idea that you have to, in Israel, if you're an Arab or a Palestinian, and if you're in occupied territories, you have to step this kind of narrow path between non-violent protest and violent protest. And at some point, you have to make a decision which is appropriate in terms of protesting against the Israeli state and what the Israeli settlers are doing, for example, in occupied territories. And he very definitely took this non-violent line, precisely because violence in Israel meets with even a larger amount of violence. Okay. So you can say that, you know, it's kind of almost self-defeating in many respects. So this moment, how they hate us, and of course the notion of how, I must be speaking far too long, how they hate us is Kafka's clever appropriation of what the Jews in Europe used to say, "Oh, how they hate us, you know, we're all persecuted." And that was kind of a fair summation of anti-Semitism. So Kafka's appropriated this and put it into the voice, if you like, of the Arab interpreter. I hope we
top of the carcass, laboring in common, killed mountain high, and now the caravan leader lashed his cutting whip scissors over their backs. They lifted their heads, half swooning in ecstasy, so the Arabs standing before them felt the sting of the whip on their muzzles, leaped and ran back towards its switch. Once more, the Arab lifted his whip. I stayed his arm. "You are right, sir," said he. "We will leave them to their business. Besides, it's time to break camp. Well, you've seen them, marvelous creatures, aren't they? And now, and how they hate us."
So I'll stop it there. That's the end of the film, actually. Anyway.
As we've got a little bit of extra time, I think I'll take the liberty to show you some of the footage that's an important part of my understanding of the relationship between activism, violence, political violence, and art, maybe media. I'm kind of actually quite interested in the fact that I'm not quite sure about the relationship of art. I know everyone here is very, or most people here are very kind of involved in artistic practices and stuff, but I'm quite keen on leaving behind art, I think. I'm not quite sure why. I don't know, I look at other practitioners, other people who are kind of on the boundary of art, maybe producing some kind of like journalistic response where they're trying to expose something, they're trying to uncover something, like, and I may be interested in more of the kind of the periphery of art and media, maybe kind of stepping away from the art world entirely, but I think often it gets kind of sucked back in, or maybe there's the relationship that the periphery can have to the inside that's quite interesting. So I'm interested in people like Trevor Paglen, I think, from a methodological point of view, and also the kind of militant research that's been produced with regards to involving yourself within a social movement, coming to struggle from the position of a researcher and kind of trying to activate research for an end, in effect. So this is one of the first videos that I was involved in producing. I won't show you all of it, but I've described it in my text quite clearly. It's a response to a statement by the Interior Minister in France, who denied any wrongdoing or any breaches of human rights in and around Calais, which is a place that I've been involved with for many years now. And this is footage that was released and filmed around one of his first visits to the city. It was kind of developed in response to a report that was produced by Human Rights Watch as well. And it, for me, it expresses a certain reality of violence in the city and
a lot of the text that's overlaid is, I think, a very interesting way of kind of, yeah, juxtaposing the kind of the rhetoric that comes out of European governments and European politicians with regards to the refugee crisis and humanitarianism, and the reality. So I guess I'll let it speak for itself. Hopefully there's some sound. We've reached the point now where we've become overloaded by them in a certain sense. But at the time, in May 2015, this was quite shocking, I think, and it received a lot of attention across the world from different people, not so much in the UK, but and I think that says volumes, really, in many ways. Oh, sorry about this. And I think that shows one aspect of violence and one aspect of a form of political violence that's one where there is a specific target. People are, in many ways, the victim of a certain form of state violence. But I think there's also another form of violence, and I think it's often one that we hear about in a very negative way with regards to freedom of movement struggles, and that's the violent resistance of people who feel that they're in a position that they really don't deserve to be in. And that often takes forms that are easily appropriated by right-wing groups, by certain forms of certain sections within society that really see that any form of militant or resistance or just ingratitude from people that have just arrived in Europe is in some way is. I don't know how to describe it, but it's basically beyond the pale. So what we also try to do is try to document protest, and some of them take on, in many ways, very violent forms. So that first video was from May, and this video was from August, during which there was a huge kind of upsurge in people trying to reach the UK, trying to destroy the border fences around the UK, around the UK border. And this video came out at a time when there was a lot of press attention and a lot of people were looking at what was happening in Calais, but I think it's important that actually as people who aren't connected to the media or who can produce autonomous media, that we try and reframe things in different ways. And I think you can see this in this video as it tries to depict the kind of form of kind of resistance. Undeniable to say that going to the UK border and trying to break down the fence is a violent act. Though it's nowhere near on the scale to the violence experienced every day from the security services against
migrants and refugees in the camps in Calais. But I think it's undeniable that that's a form of violence. I think you can talk about that as resistance as well, and I think we have to. And I think there is a point to both looking to forms of state violence and exposing them, but also trying to organise behind, trying to support, and trying to build upon acts of resistance that are often forms of violence as well. It's really interesting how often certain protests, certain direct action by people in Calais are often, they're often kind of, they're denied political subjectivity by a lot of the people who come to the camps to help. They're often kind of said that this is unreasonable, that this is over the top, and that this is a negative response because it will produce negative press. And I think actually there's something that we can do as artists and as media makers to try and reframe these events as in solidarity and in struggle with people who are in a situation that many, I think, should and would describe as abhorrent and worthy of direct action against the state.
I am working on Tolstoy at the moment, so this is kind of a spin-off from that research. This is what I sent you is kind of the last bit of the draft paper on Tolstoyan defamiliarization. I kind of shared with you the conclusions or the reflections, and what I want to do now is give you some examples of Tolstoyan defamiliarization. The paper is structured in that way. I'm not really going to say much about Tolstoy's thought itself. You can guess it from the extracts I'm going to show you. I'm assuming some of you will be familiar with the fact that he's a kind of Christian of sorts, anarcho-pacifist, and anyway, that comes through in the writings. In a sense, it's irrelevant because what I'm trying to argue is that the kind of defamiliarization he uses is itself a useful tool in raising awareness, I guess, and jolting public perceptions of political violence. So in a sense, the question I'm addressing the most is obviously the fourth one, which is, you know, how art interventions are designed to shift, challenge, or respond to public perceptions of political violence, and defamiliarization is meant to jolt that precisely. So let me just give you some examples. The first one is actually not one of political violence, but it's notorious, and it's about religion, and it's about institutionalized religion, and some have commented that perhaps defamiliarization from Tolstoy has been most noted precisely in its criticism of institutionalized religion. So I just wanted to give you that example. This is in Resurrection. It's the one novel he writes, the one long novel he writes once he's kind of converted to that perspective of the world. He's very critical of the church for not, I'll read it out in a second. He's very critical of the church for not preaching the kind of radical ethics that he thinks Jesus is all about, kind of non-violent ethics. And he has a go at the Eucharist. Which it, towards the end he describes as this. So the essence of the service consisted in the supposition that the bits of bread cut up by the priest and put into the wine, when manipulated and prayed over in a certain way, are transformed into the body and blood of Christ, of God. So these manipulations consisted in the priest uniformly raising his arms and holding them aloft, hampered though he was by the gold cloth sack he had on, then sinking to his knees and kissing the table and the objects on it. But the most important operation was when the priest picked up a napkin in both hands and rhythmically and smoothly waved it over the saucer and the golden cup. This was supposed to be the moment when the bread and wine turned into flesh and blood, and therefore this part of the service was performed with utter solemnity. The religious institutions of the day, the Russian Orthodox Church, was not impressed. That particular novel led to his excommunication, and the Russian censor made sure that the two chapters, the two long chapters, which this was just a small section of, were reduced in the official version to "the service began." That was it, the rest without. So clearly it had some sort of effect. But let me get to political violence and give you some examples there. In the same novel, Tolstoy describes at length kind of the prison system, the treatment of prisoners who head to Siberia, the whole judicial system as well, and has a good laugh with it, as it were. And at some point he's describing a particular prison guard, as it were, and he says then, The man who had the power to ease the lot of prisoners confined in Petersburg was an aged general descended from a line of German barons. He possessed decorations enough to cover himself with, but wore only one of them, the Order of the White Cross, in his buttonhole. He had seen many years of active services, but now, so people said, was in his dotage. He had received this extremely flattering cross in the Caucasus because under his command, close-cropped Russian peasants, dressed in uniform and armed with guns and bayonets, had killed more than 1,000 men who were defending their liberty, their homes and their families. Later on, he served in Poland, where he again compelled Russian peasants to commit all sorts of crimes and got more orders and decorations for his uniform. Then he served somewhere else, and now, an enfeebled old man, he had been given his present post, which provided him with a good house, an income, and public esteem. He was unrelenting in his obedience to orders from above, and was very proud of his severity. He ascribed particular importance to these instructions from above, believing that everything in this world might be amended, but not those instructions from above. His duties consisted in keeping prisoners of both sexes and casemates in solitary confinements, and in such conditions that half of them perished within 10 years, some of them going out of their minds, some dying of consumption, others committing suicide by starving themselves, cutting their arteries with bits of glass, hanging, or setting fire to themselves. The same novel has a right go at law courts, which it ridicules in a number of different ways. But the next example, I've got 5 in total, and the last isn't really one of these memorizations. The next example I want to bring up is one that is often cited in anarchist circles, or certainly in one particular anthology of Tolstoy's work as evidence of his anarchism. And so it goes like this. He says, take a man of our time, be he who he may, living quietly, when suddenly people come up to him and say, first, you must promise and swear to us that you will slavishly obey us in everything we prescribe to you, and obey and unquestioningly accept as absolute truth everything we devise, decide on, and call law. Secondly, you must hand over to us part of the fruit of your labour. We shall use the money to keep you in slavery and to prevent you forcibly resisting our arrangements. Thirdly, you must elect others, or be yourself elected, to take a pretended part in the government, knowing all the while that the administration will proceed quite independently of the foolish speeches you and others like you may utter, and that things will proceed according to our will, the will of those whose hands, in whose hands is the army. Fourthly, you must, at the appointed time, come to the law courts and take part in the senseless cruelties we perpetrate on erring people whom we have perverted, in the shape of imprisonments, banishments, solitary confinements, and executions. And fifthly and finally, besides all this, although you may be on the friendliest terms with many of other nations, you must be ready, as soon as we order it, to consider as your enemies those whom we shall point out to you, and cooperate, personally or by hiring others, in the destruction, plunder and murder of their men, women, children and aged alike, perhaps also of your own fellow countrymen, or even your parents, should we require that. Now, obviously, put that way, the central functions of the state don't look that very attractive. The last example I want to cite, and then briefly repeat what I put in the paper to you, is on war and patriotism, when he describes the next war that is likely to follow if things keep on the path that they're on. And he says, in hundreds of thousands of simple, kindly folk, torn from their wives, mothers, and children, and with murderous weapons in their hands, will trudge wherever they may be driven, stifling the despair in their souls by songs, debauchery, and vodka. They will march, freeze, suffer from hunger, and fall ill. Some will die of disease, and some will at last come to the place where men will kill them by the thousand. And they too, without knowing themselves why, will murder thousands of others whom they have never seen before, and who would neither learn nor could do them. What I do in the paper, having cited these examples and a few others, is to then try and reflect on why it might be that, as I think, defamiliarizations of violence of the sort are potentially subversive, and that's the bit that you've seen. And effectively, it is that I think partly what this does is it disrupts routine perceptions, which is precisely what defamiliarizations are meant to do, according to Schlossky, who coined the term. I think it does secure some sort of implicit recognition, because when you kind of almost laugh, sort of in dark humor at what's being said, you're recognizing some sort of truth or some sort of aspect that of the phenomenon that is presented to you. I think this is kind of similar to what you get with South Park, Team America, Bill Hicks, you name it, the number of different stand-up comedians. When you laugh, you're kind of nodding at something. And that's subversive, potentially at least. And I should say, maybe for all of these, or the majority, whatever it does doesn't mean that you land then in a subversive position. It jolts you, that doesn't mean you will then land in a more kind of Christian anarchist perspective, to take Tolstoy for instance, but at least it makes that disruption. The kind of dehumanization there, and especially the kind of humorous undertones, I think, relativize hierarchies. They're irreverent, they're disrespectful, and to that extent that's subversive as well. Certainly the hierarchies of the time saw it as such. And I think to some extent it encourages empathy, because it kind of breaks the automatic networks of affections and sympathies you might have for certain people, and you know, it flattens it, puts you potentially in that position, and potentially allows you to kind of reconstruct a different kind of set of effects, emotions for the people involved in the kind of scenes described. So to that extent, it potentially rehumanizes, to say, to cover a theme that we've touched on. And I think to that extent, therefore, Tolstoy's dehumanizations of violence are potentially subversive, and the case of a case study about activism. Thank you.